So I'd like to now invite our first keynote speaker, Tony Cripps. HSBC are the platinum supporters for today's forum, and Tony Cripps is the Chief Executive Officer of HSBC Asia, Australia. He has worked in Asia for many years in Hong Kong, and then in London, now in Australia. He was previously President and Chief Executive Officer of HSBC Philippines. He'll be talking today about seizing the opportunities in China's new era of sustainability. So I'd like to invite Tony Cripps, the Chief Executive Officer of HSBC Bank Australia, to make a few comments. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be a sponsor of this important forum. HSBC has two advocacies worldwide, education and the environment through sustainability development. So this is a perfect forum for us to sponsor. Well, China has seen a change in leadership in recent times, but also it's obvious a renewed focus on environmental issues, especially air pollution, demonstrating that the issue has moved up the political agenda. In July 2013, China's State Council released a plan to grow the energy saving and environmental protection sector by 15% per annum. That's about two times GDP. We estimate that these sectors' share of GDP could rise to around 15% of China's economy by 2020. China's rising green sector creates enormous trade and investment opportunities for Australian businesses looking to enter the China market. As part of its efforts to lower carbon intensity and improve resource efficiency, the Chinese government has identified seven strategic emerging industries in 2010 in which energy and energy saving and environment protection. Clean energy vehicles, bioindustry, new energy, which include wind and solar, and high-end equipment manufacturing and new materials. For China, expanding the energy efficiency and environmental sectors of these strategic emerging industries is a key strategy for achieving its long-term economic goals. HSBC estimates that these sectors' share of GDP could rise to around 6 to 7% by 2015, making it by far the largest component of the strategic emerging industries focus. Practically speaking, this will involve promoting energy-saving products such as efficient boilers and LED lighting, develop and expand the use of better technology, an example, efficient motors and combustion equipment, in order to increase the market share of more efficient products. Revise energy saving standards for products and energy efficiency standards for new buildings. The Chinese government is increasing energy funds available for investment into energy conservation and environmental protection, seeing this through the rise of green bonds in China. In 2013, HSBC looked at the global markets for bonds aligned to seven key themes in the climate economy, including low carbon energy, energy efficiency, finance, sustainable transport, as well as water and waste. HSBC estimates that the global universe of climate-themed bonds amounts to about $350 billion. This is double the 2012 estimate of $175 billion, so massive growth. When you consider the total bond universe is in excess of $10 trillion worldwide, climate-themed bonds are small, but they are growing very, very rapidly. Interestingly, HSBC research shows that China is in fact the world's largest issuer of climate-themed bonds worldwide. China's increased issuance in green bonds coincides with a rise in environmental, social and governance investments amongst Australia's own wealth funds. For example, in 2012, the Australia's local government superannuation, who manages assets on behalf of local government employees in New South Wales, announced a 15% allocation of green bonds within its $170 million bond portfolio. The rise of China's green bonds will be a trend that Australian super funds will be watching in the future. China's focus on energy efficiency and green technology also presents inward FDI opportunities for Australia, including clean and biotechnology. Australia has a large resource endowment, but a small population. The world's 13th largest economy, but only the world's 52nd largest population. Australia has strong R&D capabilities, including those in the renewable sector and clean technology. However, these often do not get commercialised because of a lack of capital in Australia. So China is looking to increase its FDI into Australia, as has been mentioned, and is moving beyond mining and into the renewable sector. With HSBC's own connectivity, we're linking up Asian investors with Australian companies. And anecdotally, from around 2009, we've seen Chinese investors begin to investigate the investment options and viability, particularly of renewable energy assets in Australia like wind farms. And from 2012, recently, we are now seeing them begin to invest real money. Agriculture is also a great source of potential FDI investment in the future. Agricultural self-sufficiency is obviously a priority for China. However, with 22% of the world's population and only 7% of the world's arable land, this is going to be a challenge. Australian land ownership is difficult to track, but best estimates are that about 11% of Australia's territory is owned by foreigners, of which today only a fraction is by Chinese, and this is expected to grow. Australia exports around 60 to 70% of its agricultural produce, and rising food prices have the potential to provide opportunities for Australia to look at ventures which were previously considered too expensive and uneconomical. Lastly, the growth of RMB will underpin the Australia-China partnership. And while today's discussion is about Australia-Chinese partnerships within sustainability, it would be remiss of me not to highlight the importance of the role and development of Chinese currency, the renminbi. Australia's trade and investment links with China are only going to grow, of course, and most likely it will be at the expense of traditional markets like the US and the UK. From a trade perspective, China accounts already for more than a quarter of Australia's two-way merchandise trade, and we expect this to continue growing at about 8 or 9% up to 2020. It is obvious that given China's increasing importance to Australia's prosperity, that Australian companies will increasingly use the RMB in lockstep with this growth. So ladies and gentlemen, I want to just say thank you for the opportunity. It's a great honour to sponsor this forum, and I hope you enjoy the day. Thank you very much.